When people think about Germany, there are some common topics which come to mind, however cliched that they might be. Sauerkraut, the Autobahn, German efficiency, Lederhosen, beer, and so much more. But of course, these stereotypical answers only scratch the surface of what Germany has brought to the wider world. Germany has a rich cultural heritage, especially when it comes to music, and no German musical act has lit a fire quite so bright as one particular artist, Rammstein. Rammstein has a long storied history, and it's important to contextualize the environment in which they were formed. You can't talk about Rammstein without talking about Germany, and most importantly, the GDR. If we roll back the clock to October of 1949, Germany was a broken country in an interesting position. To oversimplify a very complex situation, Germany was divided into East and West Germany, with Berlin being split straight down the middle, with the Berlin Wall being erected many years later to stop defections from East to West Germany via Berlin. The reason this was done was due to many complex reasons, but one of the main factors was that during the war, Germany was invaded by the US from the west, with Russia advancing from the east. This resulted in a stalemate once the war ended, with neither side wanting to yield ground to the other. So the US took the west and Russia took the east, creating the GDR or German Democratic Republic, subsequently enforcing their communist ideologies. This effectively created two very different parts of Germany, with very different laws and outlooks. Again, this is very much an oversimplification of a very complex scenario, which took place over decades. It was within the GDR that the seeds of Rammstein were first sown. Many of the members who would go on to form Rammstein were already in bands prior to its formation. One such band was Feeling B. Feeling B were formed in the GDR in 1983 and featured future Rammstein members guitarist Paul Anders and keyboardist Christian Flucker Lorenz. Feeling B were active between 1983 and 1994, releasing three albums during their main tenure and playing countless live shows. In the GDR, musicians were required to hold a license in order to play music, something which Feeling B luckily managed to secure. Their energetic and theatrical shows likely influenced the direction that Rammstein would later take with their own shows. One future Rammstein member, Christoph Doom Schneider, would also join Feeling B for a number of their live shows as a touring drummer. Around this time, another future member was also living in the GDR, guitarist Richard Crisper. Having grown up in the GDR, Richard had bought into the idea of prosperity and safety that the state government had promised, at least until he became a teenager. That's when he started to question not only the government, but also his own place in the GDR. Richard had started playing guitar to impress girls, but soon went on to join a number of bands for the love of music, including Orgasm Death Gimmick, Defirma, and others. After being wrongly detained for being near an anti-government protest, Richard decided that enough was enough and left the GDR, entering West Germany by crossing through various other countries. Not long after came the collapse of the Berlin Wall, allowing Germans to pass between East and West Berlin, and subsequently East and West Germany, more freely. Richard eventually settled in Schwerin, which is where he met future Rammstein vocalist Till Lindemann around 1993. Till was a basket weaver at the time, and occasionally Richard would listen to him singing, and eventually the two became friends. Till had likewise also been in bands, with his most notable being First Arsch as their drummer. Over the years, First Arsch would see a number of musicians join and leave their ranks, including Paul Anders and Richard Crisper. A chance meeting between Richard and future Rammstein bassist Oliver Riedel would cement their future working relationship. Oliver, or Ollie as his bandmates refer to him, also grew up in the GDR, managing to learn guitar at the age of 19. He would later go on to join the Intouchables on bass. It's clear that there was a tight-knit musical scene forming around East Germany at this time, with many musicians crossing between bands, and strong friendships forming as a result. With Flucker reflecting, almost all the musicians I knew played in several bands at once, and each band played a completely different style of music. In 1993, this cross-pollination of musicians started to reach a pivotal point. At the time, Ollie, Richard and Schneider were all living together. Richard brought up the idea of a new musical project with a new style. The three of them agreed to join forces and started writing new material. Having grown up on a musical diet of Kiss and other American bands, Richard knew that he wanted to pivot in a different direction and create something fresh. Till was the next member to be recruited. Having recalled his prior singing, Richard asked Till to become the singer of the band, to which he eventually agreed. Till went away and started working on lyrics, which were at this time in English. After working on music for a while, the band heard about the Metrobeat competition, a chance to win time in a professional recording studio. The group recorded four demo songs and sent in a tape. In order to submit a tape, the band had to have a name, to which they decided on Temple Prayers, one of the few names the band had considered. Others included Milch, Mutter, and Erd. In order to compete, the band also had to play live in the Metrobeat Festival show, after which the band luckily won. The very roots of Rammstein were starting to form, in particular, their characteristic sound. The demo track featured four songs, three of which would later become album tracks. The sound was raw, heavy, with a driving rhythm section and a Teutonic pounding drum sound, with Till's guttural vocals lending a dark, yet melodic edge to the whole proceeding. The group were already starting to make a name for themselves, which came under the notice of Paul Anders. Paul inquired about joining the band, and after some deliberation, he became the official fifth member. In order to complete the lineup, the band felt that they needed a keyboard player. Having crossed paths with Flucker multiple times before, the group requested that he join the band, with Flucker having only one stipulation to his joining. The band would sing in German. The band started to rehearse their songs in a small basement rehearsal space. At this point, it was unknown whether or not the band would be an ongoing project or just a fleeting thing. All the band knew was that each member continued to turn up each time they rehearsed. This was a good sign. Because the band was still living in East Germany, not all remnants of the old GDR had been banished as a result of the Berlin Wall being felled. In fact, the band still had to prove that they could perform regular jobs outside of their music, to the point where their music license could potentially be revoked, had they failed to prove this. Eventually, the band had to move on from their basement rehearsal space, opting to rehearse in an old bottle warehouse. The band would utilize old beer crates to create a walled-off area, with Till bringing his old leather couches to the space, in the vain hope of making it a bit more cozy. Using their prize from the Metrobeat competition, the band went on to record a new 5-track demo. It was around this time that they decided to rename the band, and thus Rammstein was born. The name had been a rumination of Christoph, Paul and Flucker's from their Feeling B days. Originally intended to be the full name of Rammstein Flugschau, the band changed the spelling and removed the second half of the name, settling on just Rammstein. Rammstein Flugschau refers to the Rammstein airshow disaster of 1986, where over 70 people died as a result of a mid-air collision between multiple planes, which went then on to crash into the ground, showing the band's taste for the macabre from their earliest inception. The 5-track demo was then sent to radio stations across Germany in order to promote the band. The insert would read, "Born from the most beautiful men from Feeling B, Inch to Bucketables, Orgasm Death Gimmick, and The Company, Rammstein brings together an excellent ensemble of talented solo artists for the resurrection of a generation that will one day name itself after them. Enticing German language poetry, crashing guitars, bombastic choirs, hard samples, loops, tanz metal, Rammstein is the new hope of German culture in the trash can of chewed up music markets." Multiple demo tracks were created between 1994 and 1995, with various changes and variations of songs. In March of 1994, the band played their first live show as Rammstein at Club NATO in Leipzig, supporting Flucker's brother's band, Acker Selection. In contrast to Acker Selection's much more light-hearted and fun sound, Rammstein's heavy guitar sound was quite a surprise to the audience at the time. The band would go on to play many shows, almost exclusively in East Germany. Since the members had been in a number of bands prior to joining Rammstein, they utilized their old contacts to secure shows. At this point, they were working with the old manager of Feeling B in order to expand their reach, but the band knew it was soon going to need a change. The band would experiment with their look while playing these early shows, but one thing was certain, the band knew that they wanted to look like a unit, so perhaps a uniform of sorts was needed. Another thing the band started experimenting with was their stage show. In their early shows, they would simply go straight into their first song, Rammstein, their own way of announcing their presence. After seeing the spectacles of shows by Kiss and Prince, the band knew they had to do something to get people's attentions, and so the band started performing with Roman candles, pouring gasoline on stage, and lighting Till on fire, naturally. It's unknown just how many shows the band played during this period, but it was enough for them to start making a name for themselves, at which point they felt that they needed a new manager. Another staple of the GDR music scene was Emanuel Fialik, known to many simply as Emu. The band knew of Emu from meeting him years before, across their various prior bands, and they knew that he would be the right person to contact in order to push the band to the next level. After watching one of their live performances in a nightclub in Berlin, Emu agreed to be the band's manager. Emu's company, Pilgrim Management, sent out demo tapes to numerous record labels in order to secure the band a recording contract. The response was slow at first, but eventually offers started coming in, with the band eventually choosing to sign with Motor Music. By this point, the band had written enough material to record an album, and with a record deal and manager secured, they first had to find a producer. Naturally, the band turned to producers who they knew had worked on records that they personally liked, the first being Greg Hunter, who had produced Killing Joke's Pandemonium album. After inviting Greg to watch the band play, they noticed that he was fast asleep a few songs in, which didn't impress them. The search then turned to Jacob Hellner, who had produced the album Deaf, Dumb, Blind by Clawfinger, of which the band was a fan of. Since Jacob did not speak German, he requested that the band record their album in Sweden, opting for Polar Studios. The band spent around a week recording drums here, and then progressed to Jacob's own studio to continue the recordings. Over a period of 3 months, the band toiled away at the production of the album. Richard felt that once they'd moved to Jacob's studio, things got off to the wrong start straight off the bat, reflecting that, "It was so hard for me to get the right guitar sound in there. The place was cramped and very different to where I'd been used to rehearsing. It was a real change and one I didn't appreciate. We also had a problem being in Stockholm, you see. The way Jacob worked was almost office hours, so we'd be left on our own during the evenings and at weekends. We didn't speak Swedish or that much English and felt very alienated. We couldn't go anywhere nor do anything, so our mood wasn't the best. The communication process was tenuous at best, what with Jacob's lack of German. However, they still managed to communicate in English, despite the band's fractured knowledge of the language. The real trouble came when dealing with Till's tracks. Because the band sang exclusively in German, there was a real disconnect between Jacob and his understanding of the lyrics, yet somehow the band and Jacob found a way through. Despite the turbulent recording process, the band was relatively happy with the results. That was until it came to the mixing process. The band naturally assumed that Jacob would be the right person to mix the album. However, once they started hearing the results, they knew it wasn't to be. Richard credits Ronald Prent with saving the album. He stepped in to mix the album at the last minute, and although the band never fully agreed on all of his mixing choices, they had to admit that the salvage job was commendable. The band decided on the name Herzeleid for the album title, which roughly translates as heartbreak. Not only was it the name of one of the tracks of the album, it also reflected a lot of the feelings the band had around this time, specifically Till and Richard, who had recently broken up with their girlfriends. Lyrically, the album dealt with dark themes, something which would become a staple for the band, and the music reflected this, featuring ambient synths, unique samples, buzzsaw guitars, and pounding drums. When it came to the album art, it featured a photo of the band, naked from the waist up, with a flower behind them. Needless to say, the band don't look too fondly on this artwork in hindsight, with Richard describing it as looking like an ad for a gay porno film, and Till describing it as the worst cover we could imagine today. The band also recorded the first of their many music videos, choosing the song Du riechst so gut. The video featured the band in scenes reminiscent of the album art, bare-chested and featuring flowers. Despite the lukewarm reception the video would find amongst their friends, the band would go on to create bigger and more elaborate videos as the years passed. This was followed up by a music video for the track Rammstein, which intercut footage from Rammstein's 100 Jahre Rammstein show and the film Lost Highway. The band had thought about directors they'd like to work with on music videos, and the name David Lynch had come up. Despite Lynch being a world-renowned director, the band thought they'd try their luck and sent him their music anyway. Even though Lynch didn't end up directing their video, he did agree for the band to use footage from Lost Highway in their music video, as well as featuring their music in the movie. Aside from the tumultuous nature of the album production, the band were determined to continue on and make a name for themselves. They started their Herzeleid live tour in August of 1995, prior to the album's release in September of the same year. This tour would then end in December. During this period, the band would play support shows with KMFDM and Clawfinger, taking them to new locations outside of Germany, broadening their horizons. In early 1996, the band would play more shows with Clawfinger, and eventually ended up supporting the Ramones on their farewell tour within Germany. 1996 would also see the band having their very first TV appearance, playing two songs on English MTV. This performance was distinct for its total lack of fire. Throughout the year, Rammstein would go on to play even more shows, touring throughout the majority of the year. The band would debut new songs during this period, which would show up on later albums. On the 27th of September, the band played their 100th show, 100 Jahre Rammstein, 100 Years of Rammstein, in Berlin. This would also be the first live recording the band would release, with the whole show being available on VHS for fan club members. Notably, the show would feature many of the pyrotechnic effects the band had perfected over the last few years. At one point during the show, a flaming Rammstein sign would collapse and fall into the crowd. There were a few minor injuries, but the band played on. Because the band had signed a free record deal with Motor Music, there was immense pressure to create a fantastic successor to Herzeleid. In November of 96, the band would start work on their next album. Despite the issues that they had for the production of the first album, the band once again opted to work with Jacob Hellner and Ronald Prent. This time, the main production on the album took place in Temple Studios in Malta. The production for this second album was much less fraught, with the band seemingly finding their groove working with Jacob. Musically, the album would continue an evolution of their sound from Herzeleid, featuring a bigger focus on samples and utilizing guest vocalists. On their evolving sound, Paul would say, "With regards to music, all of the members of the band have been playing in other bands and playing very different kinds of music. We were all at different angles musically. Some were playing in folk punk bands, others in punk crossover bands, and we tried from the very beginning to find something that all of us had in common. The differences were so extreme that it took us a while to find exactly what sort of music we could all make together. Lyrically, the album would also keep the dark themes from the first album, and explore more sexual topics. The title for the album was chosen to be Sensucht, being taken from one of the album tracks, roughly translating as longing. For the album cover, the band opted to work with artist Gottfried Hellenwein, who photographed the band at his Austrian castle. Each member's face was painted white, and various surgical tools were placed around their heads, creating a unique and ominous aesthetic, something which has now become iconic. The album was released on the 25th of August 1997, charting at number one in Germany on the week of its release. The band's further forays into music videos would establish their cinematic ambitions and story-led narratives, with the videos for Engel and Du Hast lending a very Tarantino-esque touch. Subsequently, Du Hast would quickly become one of their most well-known songs outside of Germany. Technically, the Sensucht tour began in April of 97, prior to the album's release, and ended midway through 1999. Through the few years that the band were touring, they had initially started touring throughout Europe, but eventually secured their first shows in the US. For the first time, Americans were presented with the sheer spectacle of a Rammstein show. In the Bank Club in New York, during a performance of Buck Dish, the band were repeating a stunt which they had regularly performed in Europe, with Flucker smashing a fluorescent tube over Till's back. However, the band did not know that the tubes were much thicker in the US, which subsequently cut into Till's back, causing bleeding. Shards flew off and hit Schneider's arm, which also started bleeding. However, despite this fiasco, it wouldn't be too long before the band returned. More touring took place in Europe, with the band playing their own headline shows, as well as supporting KMFDM once again. The band would continue to refine their live show, with their performances becoming more spectacular and theatrical as a result. This was also the period when the band recorded their second live performance for home release, Live aus Berlin. Recorded in Berlin, the show would later see release on CD, VHS, and DVD, with various versions removing the performance of Buck Dish for censorship reasons. In late 1998, the band was asked to join the Family Values Tour in the US. This was headlined by Korn, and featured Limp Bizkit, Ice Cube, and more. Despite finding controversy amongst the media and in the public consciousness, the band were yet to face any real issues when it came to their musical performances. This was all about to change. During their Halloween show, the band had opted to play almost completely naked, something which had caught the eye of the local authorities. The band were dragged off stage and the set was cut short. This wouldn't be the only time the band got into trouble with the law. After one show during their stint in the US, both Till and Flucker would be arrested due to their performance of Buck Dish, which saw Till utilising a fake penis on Flucker. This made the rest of their US tour more difficult, as the two were required to check in with the local police department every so often while they were in the US. Moving into 1999, the band would go on to play in South America, both at their own shows and also while supporting Kiss. There would be further controversies south of the border, with the band being pelted with trash at some of the Kiss shows, as well as riots breaking out in Mexico due to a planned record store appearance by the band. Even more controversy would ensue in relation to the Columbine High School massacre, with one of the murderers being found to own a Rammstein t-shirt. Despite no direct correlation between the band and the incident, the band would put out the following statement. The members of Rammstein expressed their condolences and sympathy to all affected by the recent tragic events in Denver. They wish to make it clear that they have no lyrical content or political beliefs that could have possibly influenced such behavior. Additionally, members of Rammstein have children of their own, in whom they continually strive to instill healthy and non-violent values. After a few years of touring, the band decided it was time to work on the follow-up to Sensucht. The band rented a house in Heiligendamm, Germany, in order to start writing. From September to December of 1999, they would toil away at the album. Production would then move to Studio Miraval in Correns, France, for the recording process, opting once again to work with Jacob Hellner. Over the next month and a half, the band would complete the recordings for the album. The mood in the Rammstein camp took a downward turn during this period, with much of the ire being aimed squarely at Richard. Due to the nature of the band, they had always opted to make decisions in a purely democratic way, with all members needing to agree on a decision before moving forwards. This made progress slow, and they often found that Richard would be the one stifling the process during the production of the album. Tensions were so high that the band were close to splitting, but somehow they found a way through, and the recordings were finished. The band then moved to Galaxy Studios in Mol, Belgium, in order to create their preliminary mixes, aided by Ronald Print. However, the final mix was completed by Stefan Glaumann, who had also worked with Clawfinger. Musically, the album took a deviation from the sound established on the first two albums. While synths and samples were still around, there was much less emphasis placed on them. Instead, there was a much broader palette featuring orchestral arrangements and choirs. The orchestra featured on the album was the film orchestra, Babelsberg. When it came to the lyrics, the band very much continued their process from the first two albums, with Richard explaining, "One of the strengths of Rammstein is that our lyrics are quite ambiguous. We don't like to explain or interpret them. Because we have six members in the band, we have six different opinions, and I think it's great that you can create your own story if you listen to the lyrics. We don't want to tell people what to think. We want them to be inspired to create their own story." The title, Mutter, Mother in English, was chosen for the album. Once again, it was also the name of a track on the album. For the album art, the band opted to work with Daniel and Geo Fuchs, who were known for their photos of preserved bodies. The front cover featured the image of a preserved baby that had died over 100 years prior, while the interior photos featured the band in water tanks, simulating the aesthetic of the preserved bodies. Flucker recalls, "It stank whenever anybody farted, since the gas stayed in the tank for so long." Overall, the band were very pleased with the resulting photos. Understandably, the album art generated some controversy in the German media, but the album would be released unhindered on the 2nd of April 2001, to near universal acclaim. The band would release 5 music videos to promote the album, with a video for Links 234, featuring the band's biggest foray into CG effects so far. Videos for Ich Will, Mutter, and Sonne would continue their cinematic story-led approach to videos, while their video for Feuer frei would feature footage from the Vin Diesel movie, Triple X, in which the band also made an appearance. The band had a history of being accused of right-wing sympathies throughout their career. To this end, the band wrote the song Links 234 in direct opposition to these accusations, with the band declaring once and for all that their heart was on the left. In May of 2001, the band would play their first show of their Mutter tour, with their last show being in July of 2002. They would play across Europe and North America. The tour would feature an even more expansive stage design and effects, with the band opting to enter the stage by being birthed by a prop uterus suspended from the ceiling, playing into the Mutter theme. It would also feature the first appearance of their dragon masks, flamethrowers worn on their face, and activated by foot pedals. The band would have a quiet period between mid-2002 and late-2003, taking time to recover from their non-stop touring over the last few years. During this period, the band would work on Lichtspielhaus, a compilation video of their music videos so far, as well as some unreleased live performances. This was subsequently released on the 1st of December 2003. In November of 2003, the band regrouped for work on their next album, choosing to work at El Cortillo Studio in Spain. The reason for going to Spain, according to Oli, was that Berlin was too close to our everyday lives. The band would later release a short documentary of the process. In comparison to the recording of Mutter, the recording process for this album was much smoother, with band members feeling much more comfortable with each other, and also not feeling as much pressure to create a record, which was universally acclaimed, as they had already achieved this with Mutter. The band had written so much material that they struggled to whittle it down to one album, even at one point considering releasing a double album. After much deliberation, the final 11 tracks were decided. Musically, the album featured a further development of the sound from Mutter, with Till describing it as being much more poppy. The use of synths was reduced to a minimum, while the overall production was looser and more natural sounding, allowing the tracks to breathe, while also sounding sonically impressive. Stefan Glaumann returned to mix the album after the band's positive experience working with him on Mutter. Lyrically, the album would stick to the themes of the previous albums, whilst also referencing real-world events. The track, Mein Teil, gained notoriety due to its subject matter, referencing German cannibal Armin Mives. Probably the most recognisable song from the album would be America, a critique of the spread of American culture. Typically for each album, the band would pass lyric duties over to Till, and of course this album was no different, with Till explaining, "The process I normally follow is that I take the instrumentals out of the studio, check them out, and if I can't come up with anything straight away, then I turn up the volume, listen to the music really loud, and just keep looking for the right lyrics, or jotting down new lyrics in place of the ones I already have. In fact, for one of the songs on the new album, I wrote 24 different sets of lyrics before the band said it was okay." The title of the album was chosen to be Riser Riser, roughly translating as a command to travel, once again carrying on the tradition of naming the album after one of the song titles. For the album art, the image of a bright orange flight recorder was chosen. This is in reference to the song Dalai Lama, which tells the tale of travel by plane. Leaning into the flight recorder theme, there is also a hidden track featured on most versions of the album. If a listener rewinds to before the first track, they will hear audio from Japan Airlines Flight 123, which crashed in 1985. The album was released on the 16th of November 2004 to positive reviews. 4 music videos were produced to promote the album, Keine Lust, Mein Teil, Ohne Dich, and America, with all 4 showcasing the band's refined storytelling approach to their music videos. At this point, the band clearly had a preference for working with certain directors, with Jörn Heitmann and Zoran Bihak cropping up multiple times throughout the band's career. On the 1st of November 2004, the band began their Rise Arise tour, which would continue until July 2005. For this tour, the band opted to play mainly in Europe, not visiting North America at all this time around. Gone were the clinical lab costumes and props for the Mutter tour. Instead, the stage was adorned with an industrial gothic visage, with the band wearing a mixture of gothic and traditional German garb, respectively. The stage effects would become even grander still, with one memorable moment featuring Till cooking Flucker in an oversized cooking pot during performances of the song Mein Teil. These shows would become immortalized in the band's next live release, Volkerball, German for dodgeball. Released on the 17th of November 2006, Volkerball would primarily feature footage from the band's show at the Arena of Nîmes, a famous Roman amphitheatre in France. Additional footage was taken from various shows across the band's Rise Arise tour, and the album art was based on the logo for the Moscow Summer Olympics of 1980. Since the band had so much leftover material from the production of Rise Arise, they decided to rework and release the material as a follow-up album. Originally, the band planned to simply title the album as Rise Arise 2, to show the connection between the albums, but this was later changed. Seven tracks were brought over from the Rise Arise sessions, with four more being added, primarily reworked from previous demos. It's unknown if the band entered the studio at a later date to record the four new songs, or if they were recorded during the Rise Arise sessions. Till reflects, "With Rise Arise, we had some songs left over, so then we went into the studio and recorded some more. You could say that with the last album, we had 11 fantastic players on the pitch, and we had 7 or 8 fantastic players on the subs bench. We were just as good, and we brought 3 new players to join the team, who are all excellent players. So we have an excellent new team for you." The band chose to title the album Rosenrot, Rose Red in English, again from one of the track titles. In fact, Rosenrot had originally been considered as the title for Rise Arise. Lyrically and musically, the album was very much in the same vein as Rise Arise, although the album features a few departures from the prior, with multiple guest vocalists and trumpets being used on Tikiera Puta. For the album art, the band opted to reuse the album art from the Japanese release of Rise Arise, with slight modifications to the art. Interestingly, despite the otherworldly feel of the cover, the album art actually features a real photo of the icebreaker ship USS Atka at the Ross Ice Shelf in Antarctica, with a few edits. The album was released on the 28th of October 2005. Promotion for the album was very minimal, at least in contrast to the band's previous releases. However, the band still released 3 music videos to promote it: Benzene, Rosenrot, and Man Gegen Man. The band didn't tour to promote the album, however, track Benzene was played during some shows of their Rise Arise tour. The release of Rosenrot would also mark the longest period of inactivity for the band so far, with the production of their next album starting 3 years later in February of 2008. It's unknown why the band decided to have such a long gap between albums, although Richard's side project Emigrate may have played a part as well. After being apart for such a long time, the band weren't sure if they could recapture the magic of working together, and they weren't even sure that they'd be able to produce a new album. The production of the new album turned out to be quite a difficult process, with the band moving from studio to studio and finding it difficult to agree with each other on decisions when it came to the songs. Initial production and writing took place in Berlin, but the band moved to Los Angeles for the drum recordings, and further recordings would take place in Sonoma Studios in San Francisco. The title for the album, Liebe ist für alle da, Love is for Everyone, in English, was once again taken from one of the album tracks. This album would see the band embroiled in further controversy, with the contents and packaging both running afoul of censorship. Liebe ist für alle da was released on the 16th of October 2009 and went straight to number 1 in the German album charts. Musically, the album was a departure from many of the sounds the band had cultivated up to this point, notably with the drums having a much more modern metal sound and feel. On the change in sound, Paul would reflect, "Well, back when the band started, we were definitely fascinated by sequences and electronic beats. Everyone really had a great time messing around with that sort of stuff. In the early days, we would often fire off the sequences and then spend an hour just jamming with the sequences. It used to be something that was really exciting, but after a while it became boring, because it seemed that there was no real new ideas to discover with electronics. We gradually returned more to the natural band sound, each guy on his instrument. Now you could say there's a bit of a pendulum going back and forth between the natural band sound and electronics. We try to get the best out of both worlds." Lyrically, the album would tackle the dark and difficult topics, much like previous albums, with one song, Wiener Blut, referencing real-life figure Joseph Pritzel. However, it was the song Ich tue dir weh, which would cause the band the most trouble. Due to the sadomasochistic lyrics, the album would be placed on the index of the Federal Department for Media Harmful to Young Persons in Germany. For the album art, the band were pictured surrounding a dining table, on which was a naked woman. The band were surrounded by food and mechanical Venus flytraps, with the band seemingly cutting apart and eating the woman. The photo was taken by Spanish photographer Eugenio Requenco, the meaning of which is up to interpretation. The band would promote the album with music videos for the songs Ich tu de Ver, High Fish, and Pussy, with the latter bringing the band even more notoriety. The music video for Pussy was released uncensored on the adult site Visit X, featuring the band members' faces superimposed on pornographic actors in various pornographic situations. On the 8th of November 2009, the band would embark on their Lieber ist für alle da tour, once again opting to tour in North America after a long absence. The tour would end in May 2011, the band playing over 100 shows. The band's Madison Square Garden show would become immortalised in their Rammstein in America release, which would be made available many years later in September of 2015. It's not known why the release took so long to come out, but it may be in part due to contractual changes the band was exploring at the time. The band would also include a feature-length documentary with the release, with the band talking candidly about their experience touring the US up until this point. After a drought of content from the band, fans wouldn't have to wait too long until the band's next release. On the 2nd of December 2011, the band would release a compilation album of some of their greatest hits, Made in Germany. This release was notable due to most of the songs included being remastered, and for also including a brand new song, Mineland, which would also get its very own music video. In addition to the music video for Mineland, the band would also release a music video for Mein Herz brennt, as well as a new piano version of the same song. Interestingly, the band had always wanted to film a video for Mein Herz brennt since its release on Mutter. Strangely, there are two versions of the music video, one official version and one unofficial version, although both feature the band. Originally, the band had opted to work with Eugenio Requenco once again for the music video, but after being dissatisfied with his initial edit, they turned the footage over to their longtime collaborator, Zoran Bihak, shooting a few extra scenes to complete their new version. The album art would feature death masks of the band's own faces, an image which would further be used to promote the album, with fans being able to get their own versions of the death masks in certain locations. The release would be swiftly followed by their Made in Germany tour, kicking off on the 6th of November 2011, and ending in August of 2013. The band would once again play most of Europe and North America, with their live shows being expanded to large arenas and featuring most of their famous live effects to date. During this tour, the band would also record their next live release, Rammstein, Paris, an ambitious live concert film which would combine footage from their two Paris shows in March of 2012, as well as footage shot during their rehearsals. The show was directed by Jonas Åkerlund, famous not only for working with Rammstein, but also for his work with Lady Gaga, Metallica, and more. Once the Made in Germany tour came to a close, it would be 6 years before the band released another album, marking a 10-year gap between its release and the release of Lieber ist für alle da. Looking back at this large gap in their history, Schneider reflects, "I understand the fans who are maybe annoyed by the long wait, but we need the time to be really good. That's always our standard. To get the maximum from every note. Sometimes we only go up by a few percentage points over a period of weeks, but they make all the difference. But it's not easy." However, the band would play shows between 2016 and 2017, showcasing a new song, Ram 4, during the intro to these shows. Despite the band agreeing to take a few years off after the tour, it wouldn't be until around 2017 that the band would make any real progress on the next album. In a change from prior albums, the pre-production was done primarily by Till and Richard, working together on demos. After presenting the demos to the rest of the band, they all agreed to commence production at La Fabrique Studios in France. Reflecting on the musical direction of this new album, Richard mused, "I was sitting with Till and to my great surprise he loved the stuff I was playing. There are all these different moods that he liked. Obviously, if you listen to the record, there are still Rammstein elements in there, it's still us, but we experimented a lot with certain kinds of harmony through the verses, and a lot of melodic structures in the songs. I feel like we came up with great stuff that I wouldn't have dreamed before could be Rammstein." The band made a conscious decision to not work with Jacob Hellner this time around. There were no hard feelings between Jacob and the band, with Jacob later being invited to the album release party. Instead, the band chose to work with Olsen in Voltini, with additional production work by Tom Dalgetty and Sky Van Hoff. Because the band could not decide on a fitting album title, they broke the tradition of naming the album after one of the songs, and instead opted to leave it untitled. Similarly, the album art was also minimalistic, featuring a single unlit match. The untitled album was released on the 17th of May 2019, and was heralded as a return to form for the band. The album was promoted by three music videos, Ausländer, Radio, and notably, Deutschland. The video for Deutschland was Rammstein's biggest music video to date, encompassing the dark history of Germany and the love-hate relationship that Till has with his homeland. The video and song became a viral hit. There was also a fourth video filmed for Zeigedisch, which remains unreleased to this day. At this point in their career, Rammstein were bigger than they had ever been, and with the increased fandom came bigger and more elaborate shows. On the 27th of May 2019, the band would start their stadium tour, playing in open roof stadiums across Europe and North America, in order to accommodate their larger and noticeably taller stage. Many tour dates were cancelled or postponed due to the global coronavirus pandemic. At this point, the last thing people were expecting was another Rammstein album. However, the pandemic had afforded the band extra downtime to work on new music. Reflecting on their own lives and the situation that the world had found itself in, the band wrote what was perhaps their most personal record to date. This would come to be titled Zeit, or Time, in English. Blacker recalls, by not being able to perform live, our creativity increased. We had more time to think of new things and less distractions. As a result, we recorded a record that we had not planned in this way. Returning to La Fabrique Studios in France, the band found that they had far less distractions and were much more focused as a result. They decided to work with Olsen in Voltini and Sky Van Hoff once again, with both working as producers for the album. Zeit was released on the 29th of April 2022. Evolving from the sound of their untitled album, Zeit felt more introspective and also somehow darker in its sound and lyrics, with songs featuring topics such as the persistence of time, fear, and one's own mortality. For the album art, the band chose to work with singer-songwriter Brian Adams, who took the photo which adorns the album cover. It features all six members walking down the stairs of the real-life Trudelturm in Berlin, a specialist wind tunnel. The band chose to release four music videos to promote the album: Zeit, Zigzag, Dicker Titten, and Angst. All four featured the band's impressive visual style and knack for storytelling. The band was in the midst of their stadium tour when the album was released, and they subsequently started adding songs from Zeit into their stadium set lists. At this point in their career, Rammstein are perhaps at the pinnacle of their success, playing larger shows each year to an ever-expanding audience. And despite the controversies they've faced over the years, the members have stood steadfast in their commitment to the band, and to each other as individuals. Even after 30 years, the band show no sign of stopping, with stadium tour dates promised to go well into late 2024. It's unknown if the band will release a follow-up to Zeit, but even if they don't, they can rest easy knowing that they've created a legacy for themselves which is truly unique. Rammstein have become a staple of German culture, whether Germany likes it or not, as famous as any other German export, or even more so in many cases. The band leaves a legacy which is not just measured in albums sold or shows played, but by the fiery impact they've left upon every listener, a testament to the enduring power of their incendiary artistry.